And let's start here, Scott Gressitt. Hand me this mic right here, please.
Scott Gressitt.
Yes, Misha.
What is today's date, perchance?
Today's March 27th, not my birthday.
March 27th, the year of?
2022.
I want to know, were you there when he was born?
When Theo was born?
Yeah.
Absolutely.
And tell me about it. What was the...
He was hairy.
Hairy. Mm-hmm. Continue.
He had a lot of curly black hair compared to his brothers. Mm. And he didn't cry or fuss at all. And I took him over to... I cut his umbilical cord and then took him from the doctors and nurses and took him to a cleaning station and scrubbed him down. And I talked to him. I welcomed him to the world, to the outside world.
Were any of you, any of his siblings there?
I don't think so.
Were any of my siblings there?
No, I don't think so. Just his mom and maybe his grandmother was there.
Do you remember your emotions at the time, Scott?
I was very happy to meet Theo.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you for that story.
You're welcome.
It's cool to know.
Yeah.
Thanks for talking to me as a baby.
And you're welcome.
Me into this world.
Yeah. Well, I still welcome you into my world.
Thank you.
Every day.
Quick question: are you the youngest?
Yeah.
Is there anything, Scott, that Tell me your fondest memory of Theo in just any age. And it could be anything. It could be you made him a tuna fish sandwich and he just loved it and you were like, oh my God.
Or, we were driving down Mission in Escondido and 7-Eleven was having a marketing blitz.
7-Eleven day. Here's the date.
And the sign said, remember what the sign said?
Bring your own cup, Philip?
No, it was something about being, something's real, bigger is better, or something like that. And we read the sign cruising down Mission, and Theo said, that's what she said. And he was 9, and I was slain. I was slain.
What do you mean slain?
At his sense of humor and timing. You know, I didn't expect it from a 9-year-old.
Learn from the best.
But that was from that TV show. I mean, that was popularized.
It was popularized by The Office, but I spent my 18th and 19th year living with 2 union carpenters, and every time the opportunity arose, they would say, that's what she said.
Oh, of course.
I grew up on him saying that before I ever heard it from Office.
Really?
Yeah, it was every second I would say something, he had the opportunity, he would take it.
Every second. Well,
no, I'm just kidding.
Yeah.
Not every second.
Theo.
Mm-hmm.
What's your first memory of your father?
Oh, dear.
My first memory?
Yeah.
I was told he threw me into the pool, but I don't remember that.
I did.
Yeah.
I threw you all in the pool.
It's a hard question.
I'll give you something else to think about while that's percolating in the back of mind. With my father, I remember, I don't know, when I started getting into my 20s, I started realizing some of the tics that I had of my father. Like the way I'm talking right now and sitting, it's something my father would do, right? Are you noticing any of that stuff?
Oh, yeah.
Like what? Tell me.
Some of the things that my father does that tick me off. Is that what you're talking about?
No, that's good.
Ticks.
What the fuck? No, ticks. Like ticks. When I say ticks, it's like
the idiosyncratic behavior.
Okay.
Yeah, my father used to chew on his. He'd get all intense and like chew on his. And I started noticing that I would do that. And I was like, oh my God, I'm turning into my father. You know.
Mm-hmm. Like idiosyncrasies so, like, that you share with your father.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That you're starting to notice.
There's not a lot of those. But it's my choice.
We have our parents up the wazoo.
Yeah, we do. And poor Tillman. He just hates that he's so much like me.
There's a lot of different things, but I can't really think of any of them.
It's all right.
And the rest of us?
Yeah.
Yeah. Someone else want to jump in the hot seat?
I'm just trying to think of things that you do that are similar to Scott.
So am I. There's a good amount.
Theo is very much a unique freestanding Gressitt.
That's basically, yeah.
More than basic. I mean, it's pretty fundamental.
Yeah. Yeah, I do it every day with him, yeah.
You might not
have
enough.
He's just killing time, though.
You might not have enough space yet from your father to be like, to start being aware of the idiosyncrasies that you have.
That might be true.
Yeah.
Okay.
Do you have a? If I asked you this already, I apologize, but I'll ask you. Do you have a number one memory of your father that pops up in the moment?
The way he would cook growing up. The way, if I were to go sit down and have him cook me a meal today, I wouldn't eat it. But when I was growing up, I would eat anything that was in front of me.
Unless it had mayonnaise. And is that a good memory? Is that like a...
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
So you cherish...
Oh, yeah.
The if that's what I'm hearing.
The moldy cheese, the stacks of ribs, the undercooked burgers... Balls of burgers this big,
yeah.
Not cooked.
Softball-sized burgers, raw in the middle.
Yeah, raw in the middle.
You know steak tartare.
Black on the outside, blue on the inside.
Mm-mm.
Did you like watching him cook for you?
Yeah, of course.
How'd you feel when he was doing it?
I don't know.
An anticipatory glow, perhaps?
Most likely, definitely.
Do you think if you ever had kids, you'd do the same thing? Not the same food.
Cook for them?
Hopefully.
Cook for them?
Yeah.
Yeah. I like to cook for myself. Yeah. Well, I wouldn't cook for my kids if I had any.
So you learned the joy of cooking from your father.
Yeah. Cool.
What's the number one thing you admire about your brother, Conner? And say it like this.
The way he smells.
Say the number one thing I admire about
Conner. I was joking because he said Patrick. Say what?
Say the number one thing I admire about Conner is.
The number one thing I admire about Conner is. At the moment, his style. What he's doing with his life. The choices he's making. It's what he wants to do. And I'm happy for him. Yeah. It's cool. See that.
Does it inspire you some?
Yeah. Of course.
Nice.
Thanks, man.
Yeah.
What's the number one thing you admire about your father?
How many clamps he has. Because I have to sell them in the future. Just kidding.
To collect his inheritance. We'll have to sell my clamps.
That's a good collection.
I have all the clamps.
What's your favorite thing about your aunt Kit-Bacon?
Her attitude and I don't really know how to word this, but
use words.
Yeah, just her attitude.
What do you like about her attitude?
She's badass and
she is badass.
What do you mean when you say she's badass?
Well. Doesn't take shit from my dad.
I was gonna say she is a no bullshit woman.
Doesn't take shit from anybody, really.
Nobody.
Ever. Yeah. don't know.
Awesome. We've got your cousin over here.
Mm-hmm.
Tell me your name again, cousin.
Hillary.
What do you want to tell Hillary that she, when she looks at this in 20 years, what do you want her to, what do you want to say to her now?
I don't know. I hope you're happy and that Kieran's doing well. I don't know.
That's good.
Mm-hmm.
Anything else here? What's your favorite thing about Hillary?
I love her hair. How curly it is. It's one of my favorite things. It's always been curly and cool.
You seemed like you were excited to see her when she showed up.
Yeah, I don't get to see her often, so I'm lucky when I do.
Nice.
Feel lucky.
How well do you know John over here?
Pretty well. We haven't got to know each other enough, but pretty well.
Yeah,
from stories and different
again?
Things. Just from stories and different things.
Yeah.
But we haven't spent much one-on-one time together.
Yeah.
But
John is an uncle to all the Gressitt
boys.
Yeah. I got that impression. Have you hung glided? Is that right? Have you hung glided with?
That's not right. I don't think.
Huh?
I don't think that's right. Is it? Hung glided?
Hung glided.
Hang-glid.
Sword.
Hang-glid.
Hang-glid.
You ever hung a lid?
I don't think Theo's gone tandem yet with you, has he?
No. Yeah.
Any desire
now
or no?
Now he's kind of long.
At the moment, I don't really want to go that high in the sky in just that way. Not in a plane.
That's in a literal fashion.
You've got Kit's husband, so what does that make you? The
uncle.
Uncle. Go ahead. Give me a 30-second riff on... What's your name again? Sorry.
I don't remember.
Steve. On Uncle Steve.
A 30-second riff on Uncle Steve. Here we go. He is always funny. He's always... I'm not going to start like that, but... He's always funny and... I don't know. It's kind of hard to come up with this shit immediately.
It's all right.
Sorry.
I appreciate your effort, and I love how you jumped into the fire round one. You're willing to play ball.
Pretty
brave. Yeah. How smart is Steve?
Extremely smart.
Yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Like really smart?
Really smart.
Like freaky smart?
I don't know that one.
Don't Steve. Go there.
Yeah.
Steve's done some cool stuff.
He's done a lot of cool things.
Yeah, what's your favorite thing when you think of him and you're like, damn, the things that Steve's done, like what pops in your head?
He's grilled every single time I've been here. That's not true, but
I used to grill. Do you remember those days?
Yeah.
Chicken. Got this grill that I'm afraid of, and now Steve
does it. The oven grill.
Steve doesn't share his adventures with my boys.
I was going to say, I don't have.
And he's had
that
more adventures than anybody
stories.
At his table.
Well, I got just a flavor
of
it.
No, he was in the army.
I got a 5-minute, as we were driving up, you're like, oh yeah, Steve, in a nice way, but you said many amazing things about Steve. So I'm sure you've heard stories via Scott, but.
Not that I took to heart and remembered every single detail.
I made them all.
I could share them.
How old are you?
18.
18. You've done a fine job for an 18-year-old. I think a round of applause are in order.
Thank you, Theo Gressitt.
Of course, thank you.
All right, let's swap it out. Who's next? Conner. Conner, how would you say your relationship is with your father?
I think it's pretty good, considering what we've been through. Wouldn't you agree?
Yes, well, we have been through a lot together.
Yeah.
On the upswing?
Currently?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, awesome. What's your favorite thing about your father?
I appreciate his thriftiness. I think for a long time it bothered me. But as I got older and... learned why he was that way. It's grown on me and become a huge staple of my lifestyle.
Really?
Yeah.
I think of myself as an extravagant spender.
You are. when you can. But when you can't, you're good at making do with what you have.
That's true.
Yeah.
Yeah. But it's, you're out there picking clothes and things.
Mm-hmm.
And thriving in that right now, right?
I'm eating.
Yeah, good. You have positive cash flow.
That's true.
That's a gift. What of your father would you attribute to that? I'm not sure if I asked that.
No, I understand.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, I mean, I think without my exposure to dumpster diving from my dad, I wouldn't be doing what I'm doing. And yeah, the aesthetic eye definitely comes from part of that too. Learning about how to make things of quality and how to identify things made well, whether it's clothes or furniture, jewelry.
Zimgars,
flagknots, whatnots. Yeah, I think about it a fair amount, but I think growing up, I was taught at a pretty young age that, like, just because it's in the trash or on the side of the road doesn't mean it's actually garbage. Because, yeah, we would pick stuff up and bring it home all the time. And, yeah, it's something that I'm very grateful for. Definitely one of the early learning points for me, because yeah, when I was young, I didn't want the old shitty stuff. I remember Scott would take us to thrift stores for clothes, which I enjoyed. It was like a special treat on the weekend. It was like the one thing we could like afford to, you know, spend a little money on after 2008 foreclosure crisis broke era. Yeah, and I remember being like, can we please go to Target? I need new underwear. I need new underwear. And he'd be like, no, we'll go to the Goodwill. Like, but I don't want to wear someone else's underwear, please. Like, you'll wear someone else's underwear. They're better that way.
My poor children.
But no, it was good. At the time, I was like, that's fucking disgusting. And I, you know, I didn't have the perspective that I have now. I wasn't thinking about sustainability or longevity. And, I mean, I don't know if those were your thoughts at the time either, or if it was just about being cost effective. But, yeah, over time, now I'm at the place where, like, I won't buy anything new unless I absolutely have to.
Hear that, Kathryn?
Uh-huh. Nah, I mean, you don't really need to buy anything new anymore.
It's wasteful to buy new things.
Yeah, I agree. And everything that you could possibly need already exists somewhere and was made better then than it is now. So,
yeah. Hey, Scott. Connor's your number two son?
Yep.
You remember the day he was born?
I do.
Alice.
Well, it was very similar to the day that Theo was born. I cut his umbilical cord, took him over to the wash station, introduced myself, greeted him, welcomed him to the outer planet. I did the same thing with all four boys, you know, just sat there looking at his big eyes. And he stared back at me, and I stared down at him, and we've been doing it for 26 years. And, he was the first offspring with Lisa, and the night before my vasectomy, Lisa called and said, I'm having second thoughts about you getting a vasectomy. And I said, have you lost your mind? And she said, no, I'm concerned that maybe we'll change our mind and want to have kids. And I said, I will never change my mind. No more children. And then I knocked her up on her honeymoon. So you can thank your mother for your presence on the planet.
What's your favorite memory, simple memory of Connor?
It's hard to pick one. I guess the early years on the beach in Mexico were really great moments, because we had a lot of time on our hands. And his mother and I would take him to, we had a house on the beach in La Salina, and I'd fly all day with my students and then come and land on the beach and sit with Conner and Lisa. And he was maybe a year old and just drinking in life. And it was really fun to watch you absorbing and taking it all in.
Yeah.
I'd fly out over Conner and his mother and hover and holler up into my glider so the sound reflected down, and they'd look all around because they could hear my voice, but they didn't know where I was, and then they'd figure out that I was right over them, and then I'd land. And a paraglider at close range is a spectacular sight to an infant because it's all this color and it's big and it's moving and strings and dynamic, and your father's hanging from it, so it seemed like it was an appealing thing for him.
What's the number one thing you admire about Conner?
Probably his resourcefulness. Yeah, I mean, he's super talented, super smart, gifted in so many areas, but he's, no matter what he does, he is resourceful and finds a way to get done the things that he wants to do.
Yeah.
And uses whatever is at hand to achieve his goals. I like that about myself.
Yeah.
And I like that about him.
What do you think, Lisa? Or not, Kit?
Me?
Yeah. Tell me.
About jump Conner in about your
yeah.
I think that they are very similar, and that when Theo said he really admired your style, Conner, I thought, yeah, because he got it from Scott. I mean, your styles are distinct, but in specific ways, in general terms, your styles are very, very similar.
Hmm.
It's been interesting watching your relationship grow, ebb and flow. What's better now?
Yeah, it seems like you guys are, I don't know if it was ever like bad, but it seems like you guys have a nice mutual respect for each other.
Yeah,
I would agree.
Yeah, it's cool to see. I love it. What's your favorite thing about your, that you admire about your brother, Theo, Conner?
Oh, Theo's a good time. It's funny, you know? Like, regardless of how I'm feeling emotionally, time with Theo is always well spent because, while he can be the most antagonistic, I think, of my brothers, he's also probably the most emotionally available. And that makes for, you know, nice time talking, but also easy and fun times.
Love.
We laugh.
He's a love machine.
He is a lover.
He's the most tender.
Yeah, totally. And we laugh easily together. I mean, I think that's the case with all of our family. But, yeah, when we spend time together, usually a good giggle. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you.
I love that. Thank you for sharing that. Well done. Applause for Conner.
Yeah.
Kathryn, step in the fray.
It will.
Actually, I'm going to take a further release.
Okay.
I want to ask you a question.
Hello, have we met? Yes.
Kathryn?
Yes.
What is your favorite thing about Theo?
Oh, my gosh. That he just emanates love all the time. And that I see in the most difficult of situations, he's still outwardly loving. It's amazing. It's mind-blowing. Yeah.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah.
I love that.
He is a love machine.
More.
Go ahead, you wrote down some things. What did you write for us?
I wrote, not a memory, it's like a culmination of things, because I am the youngest here of the bunch with regard to the years that I've known Scott, memory-wise and everything. So I thought I would write down some of the things that drew me and draw me to him, the things that I love about him. And these are, I could go on and on and on.
Please don't.
These are you. That, the first and foremost, and this is the first one that popped into my mind, because it does every day, that he is truly a child inside a 67-year-old, now 67-year-old body. He just is very, just this child comes out all the time. Mostly in good ways, sometimes in not so good ways, but no, very playful, and he has the joy of a child, I think, and that his love is freely given and felt by many. That he constantly, and I've witnessed this working in the shop and in other places too, but probably mostly in the shop, he constantly thinks just out of the box. He thinks of things that I don't know of anybody else that would think of those, like solutions to a problem. His thinking is out of the box. He's in a different place than most people, and that's refreshing. That he is fiercely independent, but yet he craves partnership and socialization. He likes being with people. He's a people person, but he likes being by himself too. It's a strange dichotomy. Looking at someone who knows. That his eyes light up and he squints when he is truly tickled by something, and that his laugh comes from his heart, when just genuine, authentic, you know. It's one of those laughs that gets everybody else laughing. His intelligence, that could have been number one, but his intelligence is, you just can't ignore it, which he will generously share with anybody who is willing to listen.
Oh, poor world.
In keeping with the former, his extensive vocabulary, I love it. And I love those times that I can come up with a word that he hasn't, it's rare, but that he hasn't heard before, the use of, or it is rare, maybe twice. In keeping with that former, his own unique, and now the Gressitt boys have adopted, unique lexicon, which I wish I could cough up several of, maybe skerndangle, or I don't know, kick in some here.
Skerndangle is a good one.
Skerndangle.
Flurfnull.
I don't know.
It comes up.
Zimgars.
Yeah, Zimgar. Yes. There's been a couple of vacations I've been like, what? What is that?
He no. Said,
no, it's just, that's just a made up word. It's aggressivism. I love that. The unbelievably beautiful offspring, I wish Conner was here, that he helped shape, and the warmth that emanates from them that I feel always.
Oh, honey, are you verklempt?
I'm verklempt.
No. We had the most fun with the Jewish couple last night.
Oh my gosh. They were
from Long Island.
Yeah, no. They were very colorful. Very colorful.
Barbara was verklempt.
Oh my gosh.
I'm verklempt. Do you know what that means? Yes, Barbara, I'm from New Jersey.
I could have spent so much time with them. I could spend so much time with them. Very colorful. His just soul-encompassing and warming hugs that he gives. Yeah, I could stand there and be hugged by him for forever.
He could hug or not hug
I could
for
hug
hours.
Or not hug for hours. his ability, and everybody knows this, and your ability too, Kit-Bacon, to so precisely convey a story or a mood, a feeling, a message with his beautiful poetry. Makes these things come to life that, and you feel like you're there, you know, feel like you're in his body and mind.
Do you want to get the hook yet, Misha?
I just have a few more.
I want to know before you go on.
The playout music isn't playing yet, is it?
Before you go on, now that Connor's back, I want to know your what you admire about Connor, or what you love about Connor.
That he is, that he is so much his own person, and that he, I admire, and in the little time that I've known him, relative to his time on this planet, I've seen him, you know, struggle a little bit to find his way, and then find it and just go there. Okay, I need this, sorry. and that he is always welcoming and I haven't met anyone who's so naturally and colorfully can recreate a moment or a, and it must be the theater side of him, but he's just a natural at that. And it's just a joy to sit back and watch. I love this family.
Thank you.
They're all very much their own.
We love you.
His guiding spirit, his desire to be of service to others who are in need. His uniqueness, his personal, we've just touched on this, his personal aesthetic and style. You don't know the number of times that he gets just stopped by people and they come up to him, strangers, and comment on what he's got going on, you know?
Who am you?
It's so cool. I love it. And to be a part of that, I just love it. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, all of this and more, I mean, just makes me incapable of, doing anything but loving him.
Happy birthday.
Yeah, happy birthday.
Thanks, sweetheart. You're a sweet child.
Thank you
for
listening to hang out.
Yeah. All right, next up. Next in the hot seat.
What do I love about Scott Gressitt? Oh my gosh. Scott's one of my favorite humans, for sure. I I love how our friendship has blossomed, I feel like, over the past couple years, but really the last year.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I absolutely appreciate the invite to meet, you know, well, I know the boys, but the family, so mm-hmm. that's special for me.
Yeah.
So thank you for that.
Yeah, I'm sorry I waited so long.
That's all good.
If I knew you were going to do fun things like this, talk about Scott Gressitt, I would have invited you sooner.
But I, of course, like everybody has said, I mean, Conner and Theo are just these lights of humans and are amazing. And I love how you have hung in there as a father through the trials and tribulations of life. And really just been there for your boys, all of them, you know?
Yeah.
And I think that's a powerful statement about who you are.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, you've been instrumental in that.
Yeah.
Yeah. You've held me accountable to be that and to do that. And it takes a lot of courage to hold Scott Gressitt accountable.
Holy mackerel. You're a wild one. What else could I say? I don't know, man. I love your family. These two, just the shininess of you guys, the openness. Thank you for welcoming me in. And it's cool. I can't wait to hear Steve say something. But anything you want to tell me?
Well, I'll think for a moment before I open my trap. I've been listening to you for a long time, for 13 years. Mm. I heard you speak publicly 13 years ago, and it piqued my interest. And then I kept hearing you speak publicly in other venues, and I've always been attracted to what you have to say and how you think and how you process information, but you have a big heart. And it's one thing to be intelligent and, you know, a smart ass, but it's more important to be a wise ass. And you're a wise ass.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Cool.
Yeah.
Sweet. Who's next?
Well, happy birthday, bro.
Thank you.
As kind of the elder here in this whole group, I figured when I joined this group, the average age went up 10 years, and average IQ went down about 10 points. So so thanks for doing this, Misha.
Yeah.
It's very nice of you. It's a very nice event and a good way to celebrate your 57, is that right?
Yeah, 57.
57. I remember those years.
Yeah.
So, as my only brother-in-law, you have three sisters. God love you. And I've heard stories about that, too. So, mm-hmm. They survived, as did you.
Mm-hmm.
I guess the couple of things that I would relate was just the way the boys were. And I used to love to go to the Christian Youth Theater. The boys were all just very artistic. I thought, I hope you still pursue some of those things as you get older, music and art and all the things that you do. And I'm sure that your influence has been a terrific opportunity for them to be engaged. And you always were supportive of everything they did and mm-hmm. helped them. And I still think of those days because that was, for me, it was a lot of fun. And
me too.
I've got three boys who are not 57, but pretty damn close to it at this point. And always thought having the boys was the highlight of my life.
Yeah,
so
absolutely.
Being able to enjoy your life with these four, you know, with Tillman, Conner, Theo, and Sam. Hard for me to even remember all the names, but every one of them, unique personalities and just wonderful friends and nephews. So that I thought was one of the memories that I just really to this day enjoyed going to that to see the boys and to be together with the family. It was such a family-oriented thing.
Yeah.
The other thing that I would relate was your musical talent and how not just that you were an accomplished musician, but the way you nurtured and supported Kate. And so when Kate got married in the backyard, August 18th, the 8th of 2018, right? 8-18-18, a palindrome, number palindrome. Who did she want to play at her wedding? And I thought that was, to me, just a great honor that she would, the first thing she thought of was she wanted you to be there and your band.
Miss Kate? I thought it was you.
Oh, Kate. Kate said, yeah, oh, no, no. Kate said, no, we weren't trying to save money. It was it was Kate.
Don't even bring that up. Because, you know, fucks the story.
It can be edited. Misha can take
care of
that.
Yeah, I can edit it.
No, that was Kate, right? Yeah. And
I didn't know that.
And
that's
wanted Lyle there also to sing. So it was, so obviously the influence you had on her and being close as a part of the family, I thought was just a marvelous thing and a great event. Thanks for doing that. Thanks for bringing the band over.
It was fun.
And they were dancing into the wee evening of the night, into the early morning hours.
Yeah,
so
it was a great gig.
I thought those things in the family part was just terrific. So, bro, happy birthday to you and
to
the only brother-in-law, my friend.
Yes, you're a good brother-in-law, as brother-in-laws go.
Love you, man.
Love you too.
In a manly way.
Oh, yeah, only.
Thank you.
Question or just spew?
I would just say that before that, I'm not sure. I'm sure since Scott and all you all are very open with each other, which I love. You mm-hmm. are very expressive of your love for each other as a family, which I think is a gift and beautiful, but
I'm not scratching my ass. I'm trying to get the pillow.
The timing is impeccable. The timing of this family is impeccable. I'm not sure.
We fart, we burp, we sing. Oh, yes.
I'll just say that, you know, he invited me along and was like, oh, yeah, you're going to meet my sister. And he just, the platitudes and the admiration and the love he has for you and just going on about your gift as a writer and you're a genius and just, I'm not sure how often he expresses that to you, but I think you should know that, and actually Conner too, one of the boys, is like, oh yeah, she's amazing, smartest, you know.
Thanks, honey.
So.
No, that's one of the nice traits about Gressitt men, is they are emotional and effusive. They're sexists in a lot of other ways, but pretty nice for men, right? Yeah, yeah, as men go.
Do you remember what I told you in the car?
Tell me.
That she's the strongest woman I've ever met?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Thanks, honey.
Maybe tell me what you love about Theo first, the most, just top of mind.
Well, as I said earlier, Theo, of all of them, is the most tender, least macho, most accessible, I think. Conner has a lot of his father's traits. I think I said that earlier as well. But all of them, like our father, you all are really bright, really creative, and nicely emotional. And that's sometimes hard to find.
It seems so.
People with penises.
Yeah.
So, but I have to say that I really appreciate having you out here. Families, every family is unique, and every family has its joys and sorrows. Some more of one, less of the other, unfortunately. But it's still, you know, we are
also unique in some painful ways. You know, we're maybe a little too unique sometimes. We're a really eccentric family, which can make life really lonely.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah. So it's particularly nice having another weirdly unique person to commune with.
Yeah.
Because it is lonely sometimes. But you're aggressive.
Well, I'm glad to hear you say that.
Yeah. Why?
Because I read the piece that you wrote about how when you found out I was moving to the West Coast, you vomited.
I don't remember that. No, it's nice to have a Gressitt out here. And of the options, I think you and I are probably most aligned in temperament.
Of the siblings, yes.
Of the siblings, by far. Yeah. So.
Yeah, the other two are worthless. Compared to us.
Hunt and Lyle, it's time to go grab tea while Scott and I finish this up.
No, I'm glad that they live on the East Coast, as much as I love them.
Yeah. Well, I did. I fled the family to come out here. I also followed a sick relationship out here. But it was lonely without another Gressitt. Mm-hmm. So thanks for being here.
I'm glad to be here. I love you.
I love you. Thanks.
Okay.
What's your favorite thing about your sister? I mean, how about your favorite moment that doesn't need to be over the top or extravagant?
Why not?
Well, because we've covered plenty of that in there. But it can be. I mean, we don't need to... Whatever. I will...
We were having dinner... I think we were... maybe 11 and 12 or 12 and 13, and Kit-Bacon was reading the newspaper to mother and father or something like that, and reading a football piece about the gridiron, and mother and father doing everything they could to contain themselves because the gridiron is not pronounced gridiron, and Kit read it as gridiron, and they're trying not to break up and just trying to process what the fuck is going on, you know? And I'm just watching the whole family dynamic going, do I really belong here?
Yeah. Did I cry? I remember being horribly embarrassed.
Well, your mouth was so contorted that I wanted to hug you and run away with
I you, think you I was know? Trying not to cry because I knew they were laughing at me.
Yeah. Well, and I was being it was a precious sensitive. Moment. You were being too sensitive.
Yeah.
They were just loving you.
Fuckers.
That jumps off the page, that experience.
It's funny that we both remember that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was 50 years ago.
All siblings remember that, because I've heard that story so many
times. Really?
Yeah, because Kieran pronounces words in his own ways, because he's never heard them. He just reads them, and
that's,
then he uses them.
I was actually being quite creative.
And everyone always says, like, Lyle, my mom, they always say, oh, like, gridiron.
I love that.
I didn't know that anyone else noticed. I thought it was just me, because
like
I am terminally
I
unique.
You pronounce something
incorrect. Gridiron doesn't really make any sense.
No, what? Gridiron?
Yeah,
what
the fuck is that word?
I think I improved
on
it.
Isn't that dog race in Alaska?
Right. Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Well, there you have it, honey. Happy birthday.
Thank you, sweetheart. Well, Misha, thank you very much. It's the best birthday present I've ever had.
Thank you, everybody, for playing. That was amazing.
Thank you.
Very nice
very
gift.
Cool.
Yes, very nice gift.
I will.